हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू द लेक्चर ऑन लीनियर डिपेंडेंस, इंडिपेंडेंस एंड रॉन्स्कियन ऑफ फंक्शंस। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी विल डिफाइन व्हाट डू वी मीन बाय होमोजेनियस एंड नॉन होमोजेनियस लीनियर डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशंस। द nth ऑर्डर लीनियर डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन इज गिवन बाय ए नॉट एक्स इंटू बाई एन एक्स। बाई एन एक्स इज द nth ऑर्डर डेरिवेटिव ऑफ वाई विद रिस्पेक्ट टू एक्स, प्लस ए वन एक्स बाई एन माइनस वन एक्स एन सो ऑन ए एन एक्स इंटू वाई एक्स इक्वल टू आर एक्स, वेयर ए आई एक्स आई इक्वल टू जीरो वन टू एंड सो ऑन अप टू एन आर कंटिन्यूस फंक्शंस इन एन इंटरवल आई, एंड द कोफिशिएंट ऑफ बाई एन एक्स विच इज ए नॉट एक्स इज अज्यूम टू बी नॉट जीरो फॉर एवरी एक्स इन आई। सो दिस इक्वेशन द nth ऑर्डर लीनियर डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन गिवन इन वन विल बी कॉल्ड ए होमोजीनियस लीनियर डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन प्रोवाइडेड आर एक्स इज आइडेंटिकली जीरो, एंड अदरवाइज इट विल बी कॉल्ड ए नॉन होमोजीनियस लीनियर डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन। रिगार्डिंग द होमोजीनियस लीनियर डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशंस, देर इज अ वेरी नाइस थियरम विच वी कॉल एज द सुपरपोजिशन प्रिंसिपल फॉर होमोजीनियस फंक्शंस। इट सेज दैट लेट बाई वन बाई टू बाई के बी के सोल्यूशंस ऑफ द होमोजीनियस nth ऑर्डर डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन वन। वी आर कंसिडरिंग होमोजीनियस इक्वेशन हियर विच मीन्स दैट वी आर टेकिंग आर एक्स टू बी आइडेंटिकली जीरो। सो इन द केस ऑफ होमोजीनियस लीनियर डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन गिवन बाई वन, इफ वी हैव के सोल्यूशंस बाई वन बाई टू बाई के, देन दे आर लीनियर कॉम्बिनेशन। लीनियर कॉम्बिनेशन मीन्स द फंक्शन सी वन इंटू वाई वन एक्स प्लस सी टू इंटू वाई टू एक्स एंड सॉन सी के इंटू वाई के एक्स, वेयर सी वन सी टू सी के आर आर्बिट्री कॉन्स्टेंट्स इज ऑल्सो ए सोल्यूशन ऑन आई। इट इज वेरी सिंपल, वी कैन इजिली प्रूव दिस। सो लेट अस सी हाउ वी कैन प्रूव दिस। अवर होमोजीनियस डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन इज ए नॉट एक्स इंटू बाई एन एक्स प्लस ए वन एक्स इंटू बाई एन माइनस वन एक्स एंड सो ऑन ए नॉट ए एन एक्स इंटू बाई एक्स इक्वल टू जीरो। दिस इज अवर होमोजीनियस लीनियर डिफरेंशियल इक्वेशन। सो लेट सपोज बाई वन बाई टू एंड सो ऑन बाई के बी के सोल्यूशंस ऑफ दिस इक्वेशन। दिस इक्वेशन देन then we will have a naught x into by 1 n x plus a 1 x by 1 n minus 1 x and so on a n x into by 1 x equal to 0. Similarly, for the function y 2 x we will have as we can write in a similar manner the kth equation a naught x by k n x plus a 1 x into by k n minus 1 x and so on a n x by k x equal to 0. From these k equations, then we can show that c1 y1 plus c2 y2 and so on ck by k is also a solution of this homogeneous equation. So then a naught x into c1 by 1 plus c2 by 2 and so on ck by k, the kth derivative of this, that is dk. No, we have here nth derivative. So nth derivative of this a naught x into nth derivative of c1 y1 plus c2 y2 and so on ck by k plus a1 x into n minus 1th derivative of c1 by 1 plus c2 by 2 and so on ck by k. And the last term anx into c1 by 1 plus c2 by 2 and so on ck by k. This is equal to a naught x. Now, nth derivative of c 1 by 1 plus c 2 by 2 plus c k by k will be c 1 times nth derivative of by 1 plus c 2 times nth derivative of by 2 plus c k times nth derivative of by k. Similarly, here n minus 1th derivative of this linear combination will be c 1 times n minus 1th derivative of by 1 plus c 2 times n minus 1th derivative of by 2 and so on c k times n minus 1th derivative of by k. So, we can write it as equal to c 1 times a naught x n minus nth derivative of by 1 this plus c 2 times a naught x into nth derivative of by 2 plus a 1 x and minus 1 derivative of by 2 and so on a n x by 2 x and so on. We can write c k times a naught x by k n x plus a 1 x by k n minus 1 x and so on a n x by k x. Okay. Now, since by 1, by 2, by k are solutions of the given equation, homogeneous equation. So, this is 0, this is 0 and this is 0 and therefore, we have 0. So, c 1 by 1 plus c 2 by 2 and so on c k by k is also a solution of the homogeneous linear differential equation. So, this is known as the superposition principle for homogeneous equations. Now, let us define linear dependence independence of functions. It is a very important concept in the solution of differential equations. So, a set of functions by 1 by 2 by n will be called a linearly dependent on an interval I if we can find some constant c 1 c 2 c n not all 0. That means, at least one constant here must be a non-zero constant such that c 1 by 1 plus c 2 by 2 and so on c n by n equal to 0. So, if the n functions are not linearly dependent, then they will be called linearly independent. And for that, we have the definition that c 1 by 1 plus c 2 by 2 and so on c n by n is equal to 0 will always imply that c 1 equal to 0, c 2 equal to 0 and so on c n equal to 0. That means, we cannot find any set of n constant c 1, c 2, c n not all 0 such that c 1 by 1 plus c 2 by 2 plus c n by n equal to 0, which in other words it means that the n functions by 1 by 2 by n will be called linearly independent whenever c 1 by 1 plus c 2 by 2 plus c n by n is 0, it will always imply that c 1 c 2 c n all are zeros. Now, let us see how we can check the linear dependence independence of functions. From the definition of linear dependence, it follows that if you take n equal to 2 here, that means if you take two functions by 1 x and by 2 x, then they will be linearly dependent provided c 1 by 1 plus c 2 by 2 equal to 0, where both c 1 and c 2 both are not 0. That means, at least one of them is non-zero. So, suppose c 1 is non-zero, then c 1 by 1 plus c 2 by 2 equal to 0 can be written as, so let c 1 be non-zero, then we can divide by c 1 and write by 1 equal to minus c 2 by c 1 into by 2. So, c 2 by c 1 minus c 2 by c 1 is a constant. So, we can write r by 1 equal to some constant k times by 2, which will mean that by 1 is a scalar multiple of by 2. In particular, the two functions, let us say by 1 and by 2, they will be called linearly dependent on some interval I if they are proportional, that is by 1 is k times by 2 or by 2 is equal to k times by 1, because when we would take n equal to 2 in this definition, then if by 1 and by 2 are linearly dependent, then c 1 by 1 plus c 2 by 2 will be equal to 0, where c 1 and c 2 are not both zeros. So suppose c 1 by 1 x plus c 2 by 2 x equal to 0, where let us say c 1 is not equal to 0, then we can write by 1 x equal to minus c 2 over c 1 into by 2 x. Minus c 2 over c 1 is some constant, so we can write r by 1 x equal to some constant k times by 2 x, where k is equal to minus c 2 over c 1. So by 1 is a constant multiple of by 2. If instead of c 1, let us say c 2 is equal to 0, c 2 is not equal to 0, let us say c 1 is equal to 0, then c 2 must be not equal to 0. So if c 2 is not equal to 0, then we can divide this equation by c 2 and write, we may write by 2 is equal to minus c 1 by c 2 into by 1 x. So this will be some constant, let us say some constant r, so r into by 1 x, where r is equal to minus c 1 by c 2. So in either case, by 1 and by 2 will be proportional to each other, one will be a constant multiple of the other. Now if by 1 by 2 are not proportional on I, then they will be linearly independent on I. For example, if you take the function by 1 x equal to sin 2 x and by 2 x equal to sin x into cos x, then we know that sin 2 x is 2 sin x cos x. So we can write by 1 x to be equal to 2 times by 2 x, which means that by 1 is a scalar multiple of by 2, and so by 1 and by 2 will be linearly dependent on the interval minus infinity infinity. Now in example 2, suppose we take the function by 1 x equal to x and by 2 x equal to mod of x, then we can see from the graph that they are not linearly dependent on the interval minus infinity infinity. By 1 x is equal to x, the graph of by 1 x equal to x is this line, this is by 1 x equal to x, and the graph of by 2 x equal to mod of x, this is by mod of x graph. So we can see that x is not a scalar multiple of mod of x. If x is a, suppose if x is equal to mod of x, then x is not a equal to some constant times mod of x, because mod of x is equal to x when x is positive and minus x when x is negative. So x and mod of x cannot be equal for some constant k, therefore they are both linearly independent on the interval minus infinity infinity. Now we take the case of say four functions, by 1 x equal to cos square x, by 2 x equal to sin square x, by 3 x equal to sec square x, and by 4 equal to tan square x. We can see that they are linearly independent on the interval minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. So this interval is very important here, because you can see that this is sec square x is 1 over cos square x. So if we go beyond minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, then what will happen is that sec square x is 1 over cos square x, it will be 0 at pi by 2 and minus pi by 2, so sec square x will not be defined. So we confine ourselves, and moreover in tan square x will not be defined at pi by 2 and minus pi by 2. So we will consider the interval minus pi by 2, pi by 2. Now here let us see, we have by 1 equal to cos square x, by 2 x equal to sin square x, by 3x equal to sec square x and by 4x equal to tan square x. We have to show that they are linearly dependent on the interval minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. So, what we do is we have to find our constant c1, c2, c3, c4 such that which are not all 0, such that c1 by 1 plus c2 by 2 plus c3 by 3 and c4 by 4 is equal to 0. So, we have to find constants C1, C2, C3 and C4 not all 0 such that C1 by 1 plus C2 by 2 plus C3 by 3 plus C4 by 4 is equal to 0. So, what we do is C1 by 1, by 1 is cos square x. So, C1 times cos square x, then C2 times sin square x, then C3 times sec square x and then C4 times tan square x. We know that sec square x is 1 plus tan square x. So, and moreover we know that sin square x plus cos square x is 1. So, let us choose C1, C2 to be equal to 1. So, that we have here cos square x plus sin square x that is 1, and here we will have C3 into 1 plus tan square x. So, let us take C3 to be minus 1. Okay. So, let us take C1, C2 to be equal to 1, C3 equal to minus 1 and C4 equal to 1. Then we can see that cos square x plus sin square x minus sec square x plus tan square x will be equal to, this is 1 minus 1 plus tan square x plus tan square x. So, this will be equal to 0. So, we are able to find the constants C1, C2, C3, C4. Not all 0 such that C1 by 1 plus C2 by 2 plus C3 by 3 plus C4 by 4 is equal to 0. So, they are linearly dependent on the interval minus pi by u to pi by 2. And in the example 4, we consider by 1 x equal to e to power x, by 2 x equal to e to power 2 x and by 3 x equal to e to power 3 x. Let us show that they are linearly independent on the interval minus infinity to infinity. So, in order to prove that they are linearly independent, we have to show that whenever we write C1 by 1 plus C2 by 2 plus C3 by 3 equal to 0, it will always imply that C1, C2, C3 all are zeros. So, let us say let C1 by 1 plus C2 by 2 plus C3 by 3 is equal to 0. That is C1 e to the power x plus C2 e to the power 2x plus C3 e to the power 3x equal to 0. Our aim is to prove that C1, C2, C3 all are zeros. Now, we know that C1 e to the power x is always positive for every real x. We know that e to the power x is greater than 0 for all x belonging to R. So, what we do is we divide this equation by e to the power x. So, dividing the equation 1 by e to the power x, we have C1 plus C2 e to the power x plus C3 e to the power 2x equal to 0. Again divide this equation by e to the power x. So, we have now what we will do is, let us differentiate this equation. This equation holds for every x belonging to R. So, differentiating this equation with respect to x, differentiating with respect to x, we have we get this is 0 C2 e to the power x plus c3 into 2 times e to the power 2x. So, we get this. Now, what we do is we again divide by e to the power x. So, dividing by e to the power x, we will get c2 plus 2c3 e to the power x equal to 0. Again, this equation is valid for every x belonging to R. So, differentiating with respect to x, we get 2c3 e to the power x equal to 0. Now, e to the power x is always positive. So, this means that c3 equal to 0. When c3 is 0, from here we get c2 equal to 0, and then c3 and c2 equal to 0 give us c1 equal to 0. So, we get c1, c2, c3 all are zeros. So, e to the power x, e to the power 2x and e to the power 3x, they are linearly independent functions on minus infinity to infinity interval. Now, let us consider the n functions. So, suppose we have n functions by 1x, by 2x, by nx. We have seen while doing these examples that it is not easy to check the linear dependence independence by the by finding the constant c1, c2, c3, c4 and so on. So, it is, but so there is another process by which we can check the linear dependence independence of n functions. So, if suppose we have n functions by 1, by 2, by n which possess say at least n minus 1 derivatives with respect to x, then we will check the value of this determinant. This is nth order determinant which we denote by w by 1 by 2 by n, and call is at the Wronskian of these, call it as the Wronskian of these n functions. So, in the first row we have by 1 by 2 by n, second row has first order derivatives of by 1 by 2 by n, and the last row has n minus 1th order derivatives of by 1 by 2 by n. We will see that this nth order determinant, okay, in the case of in the case of n functions by 1 by 2 by n, which are the solutions of the homogeneous linear nth order differential equation, they will be linearly independent if and only if the Wronskian of these n functions is not equal to 0 on the interval I. So, it is easy to check the value of the Wronskian of the n solutions of the nth order linear differential equation to decide whether they are linearly dependent or independent. Let us see how we prove this result. So, let us consider an initial value problem. Here, this is called an initial value problem because we have a second order differential equation with two conditions, y at x naught equal to y naught, y dash at x naught equal to y1, which are called the initial conditions. So, a second order differential equation of with two initial conditions is called as an initial value problem. So, let us consider this initial value problem. If f x and g x are continuous functions here on an open interval I, then this initial value problem has a unique solution by x on the interval I. This is a standard result. So, we shall make use of this result. Let us suppose that the coefficients f x and g x of this differential equation are continuous in an open interval I, then any two solutions of this equation are linearly dependent on the interval I if and only if the Wronskian is 0 for some x equal to x naught. If w is 0 for some x equal to x naught, then w is identically 0 on an I. So, here this is a homogeneous linear differential equation. The two functions by 1 and by 2, let us say, the two solutions by 1 and by 2 of this differential equation will be linearly dependent if and only if their Wronskian is 0, identically 0. So, this result can be extended to n functions. We are proving it for n equal to 2. So, in the case of nth order differential equation, the n solutions will be linearly dependent if and only if their Wronskian is 0. So, we will do it for simplicity, we will do it for n equal to 2. So, let us see how we prove this result. So, let us assume that let us assume that by 1 and by 2 be two solutions of the equation 2 which are linearly dependent. Let by 1 and by 2 be two solutions of the given equation which are linearly dependent. Then by the definition of linear dependence, then there exist constant k1 and k2, say not all zero, such that k1 by 1 plus k2 by 2 is equal to 0. So, by the definition of linear dependence, we arrive at two constants k1 and k2 which are not all, which are not both 0, such that k1 by 1 plus k2 by 2 is equal to 0. We have to prove that the Wronskian of the functions by 1 and by 2 is equal to 0 for some x equal to x naught in I. So, we can see from here that then k1 by 1 dash plus k2 by 2 dash is equal to 0. Differentiating this equation with respect to x, we have k1 by 1 dash plus k2 by 2 dash is equal to 0. So, from these two equations what we have? By 1 by 2, by 1 dash, by 2 dash, this coefficient matrix into k1 k2 so this is a homogeneous system of linear equations. This is a homogeneous system of linear equations where k1 k2 are not both 0, therefore determinant of this matrix must be 0. So, this implies that modulus of this by 1 by 2 by 1 dash by 2 dash must be equal to 0. So, the determinant of the functions by 1 by 2 by 1 dash by 2 dash is equal to 0, that is the Wronskian of the functions by 1 by 2 is equal to 0. So, this proves that whenever the two functions by these two solutions by 1 by 2 of the equation 2 are linearly dependent, then their Wronskian is 0. So, it is 0 for some x naught. Now, let us see we can prove the converse. So, for the converse let us assume that the Wronskian w is 0 for some x equal to x naught in I. So, w by 1 x naught by 2 x naught is equal to 0, that is by 1 x naught by 2 x naught by 1 dash x naught by 2 dash x naught is equal to 0. We are given that the two solutions by 1 and by 2 of the equation 2 are such that the Wronskian w is 0 for some x equal to x naught. So, from from that we have this determinant equal to 0. Now, let us consider the system of equations. Consider the system of equations k1 times by 1 x naught plus k2 times by 2 x naught let us consider this system of equations. So here we see, since the determinant of k1 x0, since the determinant of by 1 x0, by 2 x0, by 1 dash x0, by 2 dash x0 is equal to 0, this homogeneous system of linear equations implies that k1 and k2 are not both 0. Okay, so this implies that k1 and k2 are not both 0. And now then let us define by x equal to k times by k1 times by 1 x plus k2 times by 2 x. Since by 1 and by 2 are solution of the equation 2 and equation 2 is a homogeneous equation, by the superposition principle it follows that k1 by 1 plus k2 by 2 is also a solution of equation 2. So, by x is also a solution of equation 2. Now, from these equations it follows that y at x0 is equal to 0. If you put x0 here, k1 by 1 x0 plus k2 by 2 x0 is 0. So, y at x0 is equal to 0. And by dash at x naught is also 0. By dash at x is equal to k1 by 1 dash x plus k2 by 2 dash x. When you put x equal to x naught and use this equation, we get by a dash at x naught equal to 0. So now what do we see? That by x is a solution of equation 2 and also that by at x naught is 0, by dash at x naught is equal to 0. Now another solution of equation 2 is by star equal to 0 solution, that is 0 solution satisfies the equation 2, and also by dash is equal to 0 satisfies by dash at x naught equal to 0, by dash by star dash at x naught equal to 0. So this solution satisfies equation 2 along with the two conditions, that at x naught it is 0 and its derivative also vanishes at x naught. Now let us apply the theorem existence uniqueness theorem. This theorem tells us that in when we have this homogeneous equation or we have this initial value problem where y at x naught is y naught, y dash at x naught is y 1, then the solution is unique. The initial value problem has a unique solution. So the both the solutions by x and this solution must be identical, and therefore by star must be equal to y. So thus we can say that y must be identically 0. So k1 by 1 x plus k2 by 2 x is equal to 0 for all x belonging to I. So by the uniqueness theorem it follows that k1 by 1 plus k2 by 2 is equal to 0 for all x belonging to I, and k1 k2 are not both 0. This implies that by 1 and by 2 are linearly dependent. By 1 and by 2 are linearly dependent. Now by 1 and by 2, so by 1 and by 2 are linearly dependent. So whenever Wronskian W is 0 for some x equal to x naught, it we have proved that by 1 and by 2 are linearly dependent. Now let us apply the proof of the first part. In the proof of the first part we have shown that whenever two solutions are linearly dependent, then W is identically 0. So here by 1 and by 2 are linearly dependent. Now use the proof of the first part to say that W is 0, W is identically 0 on I. So now using the proof of the necessity part, we have W is identically 0. So this theorem tells us that whenever two solutions of equation 2 are linearly dependent, then W is identically 0 on I. Here the continuity assumption in this theorem cannot be omitted. Let us see why the continuity assumption cannot be dropped here. This is evident from this example. Let us take by 1 x equal to x cube for all real x and by 2 x equal to x cube when x is greater than or equal to 0 and minus x cube when x is less than 0. You can easily check that by 1 x equal to x cube satisfies this equation for all real x, and by 2 x equal to x cube when x greater than or equal to 0 and minus x cube when x less than 0, they also satisfy this second order differential equation for all x. So, both by 1 and by 2 are. Now, moreover, we can see that by 1 x is x cube for all real x, while by 2 x is x cube when x is greater than or equal to 0, minus x cube when x is less than 0. So, they are both linearly independent on the x axis. One is not a scalar multiple of the other. Although their Wronskian is identically 0, we can easily check that Wronskian of by 1 and by 2 is identically 0. So, this does not contradict the theorem 3. Here we are seeing that although the functions by 1 by 2 are linearly independent, their Wronskian turns out to be identically 0. This example does not contradict theorem 3 because the coefficients in this equation fx is minus 3 y x and gx is 3 y x square, they are not continuous at x equal to 0. So, because of the fact that they are not continuous at x equal to 0, it does not contradict theorem 3. Now, when suppose we consider the nth order homogeneous linear differential equation where a1x, anx are continuous functions, then the result which we proved for n equal to 2, this result can be generalized to n functions. So, we have the set of solutions n solutions by 1 by 2 by n is linearly independent on I if and only if w by 1 by 2 by n is not equal to 0 for every x in I. So, that can be generalized to this nth order homogeneous linear differential equation. Now, a set by 1 by 2 by n of n linearly independent solutions of the homogeneous nth order differential equation on interval I is called a fundamental set of solutions. And it can be shown that there exists a fundamental set of solutions for the homogeneous linear nth order differential equation on an interval I. For as an example, we can consider the set of solutions sin 2 x, cos 2 x, e to the power 2 x. These three functions, we can easily check that they are solutions of this third order homogeneous linear differential equation, and they form a fundamental set. Fundamental set means we have to show that the three functions are linearly independent, which we can easily show by using the Wronskian. So, let us consider the Wronskian of these three functions and show that these three functions are linearly independent and so form a fundamental set. So, let us consider the Wronskian of these three functions. So, Wronskian, say that let the function by 1 be equal to sin 2 x, by 2 be equal to cos 2 x, by 3 x be equal to e to the power 2 x, then w by 1 by 2 by 3, this is equal to e to the sin 2 x, cos 2 x, e to the power 2 x. Next row contains the derivatives. So, 2 cos 2 x, this will be minus 2 sin 2 x, then here we will have 2 e to the power 2 x, and here second order derivatives of each of these functions. So, we have 4 minus 4 sin 2 x, and then here we have cos 2 x into 2 minus 4 cos 2 x, here we will have 4 e to the power 2 x. Now, e to the power 2 x is strictly positive. So, we can take e to the power 2 x out of the last column. So, e to the power 2 x, and then we can take common from last column, and then we take 2 and 4 from the first and second and third row. So, I will have here 8 times what I have done is I have taken e to power 2x common from the third column and 2 and 4 from the second and third rows. So, 8 times e to power 2x. Now, let us add first row to the third row. So, we will get here. Zero, zero, and we will get here 2. Now let us expand it by the last row. So we will have here 8 e to the power 2x into 2 times minus sin square 2x minus cos square 2x. Which is minus 1. So we get minus 16. E to the power 2x, which is in fact less than 0. So, the Jacobian is not 0 and therefore, the three functions are linearly independent and so form a fundamental set of solutions of this third order differential equation. Now, this last theorem tells us that if you take y equal to c1 by 1 x plus c2 by 2 x and it be a general solution of the homogeneous equation. Equation 2, then it includes all solutions of equation 2. So, let us see how we get this. Let y equal to c1 by 1 plus c2 by 2 be a general solution of equation 2 on an interval I, where the coefficients fx and gx are continuous, and y be any solution of equation 2 containing no arbitrary constants, then this y is obtained from 4 by assigning a suitable value to the constants. So, this general solution includes all solutions of the equation 2. So, this is what is conveyed by this theorem. With this, I would like to conclude my lecture. Thank you very much for your attention.